Then ask the next question. Brother, in your musalla, in your maslak, in your madhab, in the Hanafi musalla, if a man is in wudu, and if accidentally he touches a woman, or a woman touches him, does he go outside the state of wudu, or is he yet in the state of wudu? In Urdu we say, wudu tootti hai kya nahi? Does the wudu break or not? In English, we will say, is he yet in the state of wudu or outside the state of wudu? So the Hanafi will reply that in the Hanafi madhab, the wudu does not break. I said, fine. Let's go to the next question. In the Shafi madhab, in the Shafi musalla, if a man accidentally touches a woman, or a woman accidentally touches a man who is in a state of wudu, is he yet in the state of wudu or outside the state of wudu? Uski wudu tootti hai kya nahi? Does his wudu break or not? The reply will be, MashaAllah. All of you know it. Simple question, simple answer. The wudu breaks. It's nothing difficult. All these questions so far are simple. In the Shafi musalla, the Shafi madhab, the wudu breaks. My next question, again very simple. I ask the question, dear brother, can both be simultaneously correct? That one Muslim's wudu breaks when it accidentally touches a woman, and the other Muslim's wudu doesn't break when he accidentally touches a wudu, when he touches a woman accidentally. Can both be simultaneously correct? I'm not asking who's correct. For who is correct, you may have to have knowledge of Quran and Hadith. My question is simple. Can both be simultaneously correct? No. Simple question, simple answer. No reward for that. If I pose you the question, one teacher teaches 2 plus 2 is not equal to 5. And the other teacher teaches 2 plus 2 is equal to 5. Can both the teachers simultaneously be correct? Yes. The person who doesn't know maths may say yes. I agree with the brother. The person who doesn't know maths may say yes. All those who know basics of maths, who have passed even standard 4, will say no. Because everyone knows 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. So the first question is, if one teacher said 2 plus 2 is not equal to 5, other teacher said 2 plus 2 is equal to 5, can both be correct simultaneously? The answer is no. Simple. I believe most of you may have passed standard 4. But if I asked you a slightly difficult question, 375 multiplied by 625 is equal to 1,525. One teacher says that. The other teacher says 375 multiplied by 625 is not equal to 1,525. Can both be correct simultaneously? You don't have to be a mathematician. Which is correct, if I ask you, who is correct, then you may have to take a calculator and calculate. Even if you don't know maths, but if you're logical, one says is equal to 1,525, the other says is not equal to 1,525. Even if you don't have a calculator, you don't know maths, both simultaneously cannot be correct. To know which teacher is correct, who is correct, you may have to take a calculator and press the button, and then you may give the answer. Either the first or the second is correct. Fine? Everyone is with me? MashaAllah. So similarly, to say who is correct or which madhab is correct, the Hanafi or the Shafi, can both be simultaneously correct? The answer is no. But which madhab is more correct? What is the reply? The same reply. You have to check up in the authentic sources. Number one is Quran. Number two is Hadith. Correct. So now, this answer, who is correct, Hanafi or Shafi, here everyone will not know unless he has strived in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has strived to find out the truth. Now, when we read the Quran, it's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5. Verse number 6. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Oh, you who believe, when you prepare yourself for Salah, wash your face and your hands and arms up to the elbow. Rub your head with water. Wash your feet up to the ankle. That means doing wudu is compulsory before Salah. And if you are in ceremonial impurity, you have to bathe. You have to have a bath. And the verse continues. Or if you are ill, or on a journey, or when you come back from the call of nature, offices of nature, or if you are in contact with women, or if you touch a woman, and if you do not find water, take clean sand or earth and rub it on your face and your hands. Talking about tayammum, if there's no water, do tayammum. So based on this verse of the Quran, which says that if the woman touches, if you touch a woman, the Arabic word is lamas, coming from the word masah. So based on this, that if the woman touches, or if you touch a woman, you have to do wudu. Or if no water is there, you have to tayammum. Now, or you have to bath. Bath or wudu or tayammum. Three options. If there's no water, tayammum. Now, as far as the Arabic word masah is concerned, it has got two meanings. If you look in the dictionary, what is the meaning of masah? It has two meanings. One is a physical touch, the other is a sexual touch. So, two great Aimmas, they were great scholars. Imam Abu Hanifa, Rahimullah, may Allah's mercy be on him. He took the meaning that if you sexually touch a woman, then doing wudu or having a bath becomes compulsory. The masaya mentioned is sexual touch. Therefore, physically if you touch a woman, the wudu does not break. Imam Shafi, may Allah have mercy on him, rahimahullah, he took the meaning physical touch. Masaya has got two meanings. Anyone can be right. So he took the meaning physical touch. So according to the Hanafi school of thought, sexual touch breaks the wudu, physical touch does not break a wudu. According to Shafi school of thought, even physical touch of a woman breaks the wudu. You become outside the state of wudu. Now, masah has two meanings. Each scholar took one meaning. But the best commentary of the Quran is the Quran itself. And if you don't find it in the Quran, then go to the next source, that is the hadith. But when we look up at the other verses of the Quran, if you read Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 47, this word of masa is even present there. It speaks about the story of Maryam alayhi salam, that when the archangel Gabriel, he comes and gives her the message that you shall have a son. So the reply of Hazrat Maryam, may Allah be pleased with her, she says in Surah Al-Imran chapter number 3, verse number 47, that how shall I have a son when no man has touched me? The same word, the same root word, masa, is there. Now, any one of us will understand when Hazrat Maryam, may Allah be pleased with her, when she says that how shall I have a son when no man has touched me, it means sexual touch, does not mean physical touch. Because physically, if someone touches a woman, she need not have a child. But sexually, if someone touches, chances are she'll have a child. So she says, how shall I have a son when no man has touched me? And the reply comes, when Allah decrees a matter, Allah says, kun fayakun, be and it is. That's the full context. But the word masa here means sexual touch. Further, when we read the hadith of Prophet Muhammad, if there's a doubt, if you can't understand certain verses of the Quran, you have to go to the next source, that is the hadith, and see to it that the hadith is authentic, is sahih. There's a hadith, a sahih hadith, of Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter number 70, Hadith number 179. Hadrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. She said, once the Prophet kissed one of his wives and he went for prayers. He did not perform ablution. So Urwa, may Allah be pleased with her, she asked, who can it be other than you? She told Hadrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. And Hadrat Aisha laughed, indicating that yes, it was her. So the Sahih Hadith of Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter number 70, Hadith number 179, classified as Sahih by the Muhaddithin, including Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani. It says when Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was in the state of wudu, he kissed his wife Hazrat Aisha and went for Salah without doing wudu again. This indicates that physical touch does not break the wudu. There are several such Sahih Hadith. Even if you read Sahih Bukhari, if you read the Hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, it's mentioned that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she narrates that I was between Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Qibla when the Prophet was praying. And before he did the sujood, he pushed my leg and I moved my leg aside, indicating that in the Salah, the Prophet touched the leg of Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, and yet continued the Salah, indicating that physical touch does not break the wudu. And there are several Sahih Hadith, other Hadith, which prove to us that physical touch does not break the wudu. This Hadith is of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, Hadith number 519. Now I'm asking the question, right? The opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa,